Also, this is Keita Xagawa. So today, I will talk about fault injection attacks against NIST's post-quantum cryptography RAND 3 KEM candidates. So this is a joint work with Akira Ito, Rei Ueno, Junko Takahashi, and Naofumi Homma. Let's start. This is the agenda of this talk. So I first talk about PQCs, and next I will review PKE, KEM, and transformation, FO in short. Then I will talk about key recovery attacks using workloads and fault injection analysis and skipping the equality tests. And I finally wrap up. Okay. So I start with why we should use PQC. So recently, several companies or universities or organizations developed quantum computers. For example, in 2019, Google and IBM announced they constructed 50 qubits quantum computers. In the last year, so Chinese University, USDC, developed 76 qubit quantum machines. And this year, so I think IBM announces a 128 qubit mass. So therefore, so the number of qubits becomes larger and larger. And we know that so scalable quantum computers solve factoring or discrete logarithms problem by Schwarz algorithm. So therefore, so if such big quantum computers are available, the adversary will be quantum. So this red sign is a sign of adversary in this talk. So therefore, so we cannot use RSA signature or encryption or discrete logarithm-based signature or encryption if the big quantum computer are available. So there are several countermeasures. The first one is they use quantum cryptography. So for example, so we can use QKD to share a key secretly. But unfortunately, so they need a quantum communication channel. So there and we need special machines for QKDs. The second one is the use of post-quantum cryptography, PQC, which is so classical cryptographic algorithms, but so they will be resilient against quantum attacks. So therefore, so in this talk, we focus on the PQC. And so it is less offered, less referred, but so there's another countermeasures to use long RSA or DIA key. So for example, so Bernstein, Fried, Henninger, Rowe, Valenta proposes use a long RSA keys in NIST PQC RAND 1. But since it is impractical, so we often use a PQC as countermeasures. So therefore, so NIST in USA start to standardize PQC algorithms. So in round one, so this is started in the last year. So they select KEMs and signature schemes in this slide. So there are the four final schemes. So the one is called best one, and the three is lattice best KEMs. And there are the five alternate candidates for KEM. So there are the two code based KEMs, Bike and HQC, and the two lattice based KEMs, Float KEM and N2 prime, and one RSA based KEM, SIKE. So in this talk, so we focus on those nine KEMs, and survey its physical security. Okay. So next, I want to talk about review in PKE and KEM and Fujisaki-Homma transformations. So this is the syntax of PKEs. So PKE consists of gen and enc and dec. And gen is a key generation algorithms which produces a key pair EK and DK. This is the encryption key and decryption key. And enc algorithms takes EK and a message M as input. It outputs a ciphertext CD. On a decryption algorithm takes DK and CT as input and outputs a message M or rejection symbol port. Therefore, so if the receiver sends EK and the sender sends the ciphertext, then so the receiver can receive M securely. Next, so let's review KEM. So KEM is a sort of key encapsulation mechanism. KEM consists of the three algorithms, gen and encapsh and decapsh. Gen generates a key pair EK and DK as a generation algorithm or key generation algorithm of PKE. And encapsulation algorithms takes EK as input and output ciphertext CT and a key K. And the decapsulation algorithms takes DK and CT and it outputs K or rejection symbol both. So in this, if we the sender and the receiver use KEM, then so the receiver and the sender will share this K securely. So this is a syntax of KEM. And we often construct a strong secure KEM from weakly secure PKE. The most well-known such transformation is a Fujisaki Okamoto transformation and its variant. So this is a KEM version of Fujisaki Okamoto transformation. So in this case, so KEM is constructed by PKE and two random oracles, G and H. So here, so G is an idealized version of the PRG, and H is an idealized version of a key derivation function. So the key generation algorithm of KEM is this KEM is the same as that of PKE. And the encapsulation algorithms takes EK as input and X as a randomness. And the ciphertext is the encryption of X of encryption of X with a randomness G of X. And a key is generated by the H of X. And in the expression, so it takes DK and CT as input. It first decrypts ciphertext as X prime. And if we encrypt X prime, so which is like this one, and if it is equal to the input ciphertext, then so this X is X prime is corrected one, and the ciphertext is correct valid. Then the decapitation algorithm output the H of X prime. And otherwise, it returns the bot. So we know that FOKM is indo-CCA secure in random oracle model if PK is the one-way CPA secure. And so it, correctly speaking, it requires additional properties. But so this is a simplified version. And recently, so since we consider a quantum random oracle model, so there's a new techniques for PQC, several techniques for PQC of PQC version of FOKM. So next, I want to talk about the key recovery attacks using oracles. The first one is a key mismatch oracle. So key mismatch oracle is available if we use a key exchange with fixed secret. So for example, so the sender, the receiver send EK, and the sender will send CT and use the decapsulated result K prime as a key of after the protocol. So in this case, so if the sender consider the key of this, and the receiver uses K prime. And if the protocol becomes inconsistent, then so the sender can detect, oh, its guess is incorrect. So therefore, so using after protocol after the key exchange, so it can check the result K prime is equal to K of guess or not. So if the receiver uses this EK as a fixed ship, EK as a fixed public key, then so the sender can use such key mismatch oracle And so therefore, if the KEM is very weak, then so we can consider key recovery attack using the key mismatch oracle against this KEM. So this is a model of this illustration. So next, we can consider a plaintext checking oracle and the key recovery attacks using it. So let us consider the KEM with a Fusaki Okamoto transformation and the key exchange with fixed secret. So in this case, we can use the key mismatch oracle, so which checks decapitated result K prime is equal to its guess, K guess or not. So if this is KEM is implemented with the Fusaki Okamoto transformation, then so we can this check implies this check. That is, so we can check h of x prime is equal to h of x yes or not. So correctly speaking, if the validity test is passed. So therefore, so we can implement the plaintext checking workflow or PK as long as its input ciphertext is valid. So therefore, so we can consider such a key recovery attack using the plaintext checking workflow against PK like this form. Okay. And the next one is the faulty decapitation workflow, so which is defined in this talk. So let us consider KEM with FO, and unfortunately, the decapitation workflow ignores the validity test, so equality check test. So in the case, so faulty decapitation workflow always return the H of X prime, which is irrelevant to the input ciphertext is valid or not. So in this case, so we can consider a key recovery attack using such faulty decapitation workflow against KEM and PK, and this is modeled as this illustration. Okay, so now let us see an examples. So in this talks, I wanted to review the Kaiba. So this is a Kaiba's definition, public definitions, but we don't need all of them. The important point is ring of Q is the ZQ of X divided by an EDR generated by X to the 256 plus 1. And this precisely is a centered binomial distribution over the range between the minus 3 to plus 3 to the 256. And please remember that so this decryption key is this S, and S is generated by this psi 3 square. So we can consider that this DK of S as a 512 dimensional vectors, and its coefficients are between -3 and 3. And the important point is the decryption algorithms. So decryption algorithms first decompress its input U prime and V prime to the U and V, this one. And its output the message, this mu prime, as a near of 2 over 2 times V minus US, and taking the modulo 2. Right, yeah. So this computation V minus US is somewhat like this computation. Okay, so first important is this definition of R2 and file 3 and the decryption algorithms. So therefore, so if there's no guard, so that is if we don't apply the FO, then so this is secure only in the industry PSS. So therefore, so we can mount a key recovery attack using the plaintext checking oracle against this plain Kaiba. So in this of Fugenin, Dumitan, and Bodoni, consider concrete key recovery attacks using a plain text Oracle against this Kyber. So in the idea, so we consider a U as a pair of U and zero, and V is a T times X to the I. So this U is just a constant. And so if we consider this U and V, then so decrypted plain text mu prime is defined as this one, these two equations. So mu I prime is a near of 2 over 2 times T minus U S I, taking modulo 2. And the mu j prime is a near of 2 over 2 times minus U S j, and taking modulo 2. So this means that, so this, so here, so we consider the range of minus US and T minus USI. So minus U, so since SI is between in the minus 3 to 3, so it, and so carefully setting the U, so we can the range of minus US into in the range between the minus 2 over 4 and 2 over 4. And this, so if the coefficient in this range is decrypted into the zero always. And so here if we consider another mu I prime, so this is dependent on T minus USI. So therefore, so we can shift the range of minus USI by using this T. And so sum of T minus USY will decrypt it into the one. So if it is larger than the 2 over 4. So therefore, so using this idea, we can determine SY by checking mu I prime is equal to 0 or 1. And indeed, so we can use concrete U as a minus 276. And if so, so the mu I prime is computed at this table, depending on T and SKI. Okay. So since each coefficient is between the minus 3 to 3, so we need 3 queries to determine the SKI. So since SK is 512 coefficients, so we need 1,536 queries to determine SK completely. So next, I want to talk about the number of queries reduced by using a 40 decapitation oracle. So in the case of 40 decapitation oracles, so we can, the adversary can see each of mu prime itself, this one. So let us consider an example. So we want to determine 4 questions in parallel. So in this case, so we consider U, capital U is a pair of U and zero, and the capital V as a T0 plus T1X plus T2X square plus T3 times X cube. And if we decrypt it, this U and V, then so mu zero prime and mu one prime and mu two prime and mu three prime is computed as this form. And the other coefficients are computed as this form. So therefore, so we can determine S0 and S3 by checking H of mu prime is equal to H of 0000 and 000 and H of 1000 or 0 and so on, and H of 1111 and or 0. Okay. So by using this technique, so we can use the 3 queries to determine SK0 to SK sub A minus 1. So by checking the 2 to the A candidates. So therefore, so if we determine A coefficient in parallel, so we just need 1536 over A queries to determine SK completely. So therefore, the 40-day cancellation oracle allows us to the reduce of number queries in the case of Kaiba or Saber and N2L prime and float KEM also, float KEM. So this is the so special attacks against the lattice-based KEMs. And so this is a survey of existence of KRE PCO and which can be implemented by our next fault analysis, fault injection analysis. And so this shows that so Kaiba and Saber and fault KEM on the N2L prime and N2L and the stream by the N2L prime, all of them are vulnerable against the key recovery attack against the brain checking oracle if there's no gap. And she, so she, appendix C of our full paper for attacks against the other schemes, code-based one and the SGN-based one. So we also, we survey them. Okay, so next we consider so fault injection analysis to implement such a fault decapitation oracle. So this is a FOKM or decapitation algorithm of FOKM. So here, so decapitation, it first decrypts ciphertext into X prime and it re-encrypts it and compare with the cipher into ciphertext. And if compared the result, if the re-encrypted ciphertext is equal to the input ciphertext, then it will return H of X prime, and otherwise it returns both. So the idea is very simple. So if we skip the equality check, then this decapitation oracle always returns H of X prime. So therefore, so if we skip this step to this equality test by injecting so something, so power, for example, power glitch, we have 40 decapitation oracle or battery. Okay. Okay, and so we survey all KEM schemes in PQM4, so which is so very good library in open source library, implement such KEM candidates and the signature candidates. So for example, so then the first one is CCA back in N0 prime. So therefore, so in N0 prime case, we don't need such fault injection analysis to mount a key recovery attack. So this function is compares the input ciphertext C and C2 and return zero if C is equal to C2 and minus one otherwise. But so let us see this computation. Okay, so this function returns zero. So the final, okay, let us see this final line. So 1112. So this is the return minus one, minus difference bit minus one to shift, right shift with 31 bits, like this one. And this line returns zero if this D is equal to zero and it returns minus one otherwise. And in this line, 1099. So this D is initialized with zero, like this one. So uint 16, so different bit is set as zero, this line. But unfortunately, so this different bits, it remains zero to this here. So because, so there's another different bit two here, and this different bits changed as a result of compare the result ciphertext and ciphertext C and C2. So therefore, so this different bit is untouched, and so this function always returns zero. Okay. Fortunately, so this is fixed in this July. The next one is the timing bug in fault KEM. So Guo, Johansen, and Nilsson proposed a key recovery attack against the fraud chain to using this timing bug. So here, so the two ciphertexts are compared by this one. So B, so we first compare the part of ciphertext BP and BBP, and compare another part of ciphertext C and CC here. So since this compared result is connected with this AND, so if BP is not equal to BBP, then so it returns this SS rapidly. So therefore, so using this timing bug, so Go and Johansen and Nielsen are succeed to mount key recovery attack against fraud chain. And unfortunately, this timing bug is repaired in the fraud chain's implementation, but this timing bug remains in P2M4. And so this is also fixed in this September. And so we are sorry that so while we point out this timing bug, but we didn't submit patch to P2M4. So we next talk about a fault injection attack against SEPA and Kaiba and NTRU. So SEPA, Kaiba and NTRU use a conditional move to make change the result use depending on the comparison result like this one. Yeah, so this program is a decapitation algorithm of Saber. So it's decrypted ciphertext into this buff and so apply something and compute this flag fail as a comparison result or re-encrypted result and input ciphertext this C. And after this C conditional move, the half of this variable KR is set to as a G1 of X prime and hash public key if this fail flag is zero. So that this fail flag is zero if the encrypted ciphertext and the input ciphertext C is equal. And the half of the KR is set to be sheet otherwise. And this line 17 is computed a KDA function, this SHA-3, and you compute this K. So here, so this K is involves this X prime. So if the fail flag is zero, and it will be this pseudorandom value otherwise. Okay. So this program is compiled into this assembly program, this one. So this block. This block calls this SHA-3. So this is related to this line 14, this one, SHA-3. And so there are some instructions. So this block calls this CMOP function. And this is corresponding to this line 15. And in this line 7, line 14, so this block calls this SHA-3. So this is corresponding to this line 17, this one. Okay. So therefore, so if we skip this line 8 by injecting the fault, so this program doesn't call CMOP function. So therefore, so if we skip this line 8 in this right hand side, so as a result of this program is K as this H of G1 of X prime and hash value and H hash of hash to ciphertext always. So therefore this leaks the created result X prime always. So in the case of bike and cycle, so the program is more complicated, but anyway, so fortunately, so we can find a single step. So allows us to fault injection analysis. So we also experiment this fault injection analysis in desktop, like this one. So we use a chip whisperer to mount this board. So this, so here is a program that Cortex-M4, and we inject the power grid by using this capture box. As experimental results, we obtained the following tables. So we try to KEM, Kyber, Saber, Entoru, and Bike and Psych, this one. And we run 100 skip trials. And so each trial takes about 0.1 second to 10 seconds. So as a result of 100 trials, we succeed 42 cases in Kyber, 46 cases in Light Saber, and about 33 cases in Drew, 34 cases Bike, and 15 cases Psych. So therefore, at least we can succeed to inject a single injected fault at least 15%. Therefore, so we consider our fault injection analysis is practical. Okay, let us wrap up. So this is a summary of our findings. So we found that existence and key recovery attack using the plain text checking workflow or fault decapitation workflow for all KEMs except classic microwaves. And we also survey a real-world implementation in PQM4, and we found the timing bug in float KEM and CCA bug in Entoru Prime, and the other ones, so Kyber, Entoru, Saber, Bike, and Psych, they're the vulnerability against the fault injection analysis. So as a result, so effect of fault injection analysis summarized at this table. So here, so KR means key recovery, and KL means key leakage. So therefore, we can mount the key recovery fault injection analysis against the Kyber, Entoru, Saber, and Bike, and for the KEM and the Entoru Prime and Psych, and so on. So in this talk, we will have a key recovery attack using the plaintext checking workflow and the fault decapitation workflow. And in addition, so fault decapitation workflow setting reduces the number of queries for Kyber, Saber, fault KEM, and Entoru Prime. We also mount a fault injection analysis to skip the equality check of physical account transformation. So we also leave three open problems. On the theoretical side, so we want to study so key recovery attack using the plain text checking workflow or fault decapitation workflow against the classic materials and the Bike. So there's no result, especially on the classic microwaves. And we also, practical side, we also require a secure implementation, which is resilient to our single step skipping fault injection analysis. Thank you.